What's up, my comm fam? Today we're doing the second discussion of Plautus. It is a Tuesday afternoon. I know I owe you a lecture, and so here it is. Should I jump right into it? No, actually, you know, I need to talk about the paper first a little bit. I've received a couple of emails. Listen, don't overcomplicate the situation. I just want 4 or 5 pages, 1,100, 1,200 words on the theme of Nostos. And outside of that, it's up to you. Whatever you want to apply, whatever you want to argue, I don't expect secondary sources to be referenced. I know I said that on the April Fool's video, but I didn't really mean it. What I do expect, though, is for you to be able to prove your argument from the text, and that means quotations, and quotations don't count on your word count. So don't think that you can just fill out everything by means of quotation. I don't know what else to say about it outside of that. So let's get into, we're going to talk about Plautus's, which one are we doing today? Hahnenhaus. I like this play a lot. Again, this goes back to modes of comedy in terms of their, in terms of the language contained within the comedy, but also in terms of the kind of slapstick value of it. Lots and lots of slapstick in Aristophanes. You might argue there is nothing but slapstick in Aristophanes. And comparatively, next to none in Menander. But with Plautus, we get back to the sort of slapsticky thing. And I know I mentioned this in the last lecture, but I want to go over this just one more time, is that Plautus's plays, and this will also be true for Terence when we get to Terence, but in the next lecture, but Plautus's plays were performed in kind of outdoor, I think it would be fair to call them sort of makeshift settings. This gets back to the funny relationship that the Romans had to Greek culture. They didn't build a permanent theater in Rome until 200 years later, basically. And so there is a kind of, with Plautus, this would be less the case with Terence, but with Plautus, there is a kind of open air sort of festival feeling to these things. They're a bit more rollicking. So let's talk about, let me see if there's anything else I want to, I mean, there's different kinds of Roman comedy, Fabula Palliata, Fabula Togata, so these are played at festivals. I mean, Greek comedy was played at festivals too, you know, the Dionysia, the Lanaia, these are performed at what are called ludi romana, which means Roman parties, if we want to use that term for it. So let's talk about the Hahnenhaus for a moment. Again, I'm not going to go too deeply into the plot of this play because you should have read it, and it's not that complicated. It's not like you're reading, you know, Plato here. Excuse me. So again, you have middle class family setting. They're not too rich. They're not too poor. The dad's in business. He wants his son to take over for him at some stage, but the son is young and impulsive, and therefore lands himself in a pickle. But never fear, the clever slave is here to help get him out of it, right? So you have In fact, actually, this is a good thing to talk about. So you got two slaves in this play, Grumio and Tranio. Grumio, who is he oversees the affairs out in the lands that the family owns out in the countryside, and Tranio is the guy who is the kind of caretaker in the city. So we get back to this city-country divide. So here's one thing that I do want to talk about from a deeper sort of perspective, is that this is a good example of where we see the shift from Greek comedy to Roman comedy, insofar as in with specific respect to the symbolism of city and country. In Greek comedy, the countryside is the place of release. It's the place where laws don't necessarily apply, rules of moral behavior don't necessarily apply, or at least can be bent to one extent or another, whereas the city is the place of strict morality, where you have to kind of like follow all these laws and all these concepts. When we get to the Romans, things kind of flip over a little bit, insofar as that, I shouldn't say flip over a little bit, they almost entirely flip over, but like the city is now viewed as the place of corruption, and the countryside is viewed as the place of morality, of strict uprightness. Why is that exactly? Well, this has to do with the way that the Romans thought about themselves. That the true Roman was the man who owned land in the countryside, and if it was up to him, he would spend his time in the countryside and tend to his farm, which means, govern his slaves. But that was their ideal life, but they all knew that the people of the city were too dumb to rule themselves, and so it was their duty to go in and get themselves involved in political affairs. And this is I don't want to call it a myth, that's the wrong word for it, but it's a kind of a cultural self-perception that will go on for many centuries. So Grumio is the country slave, which means that he works hard and he does things the right way, right? We remember Daulos in the Daedalus, and Tranio is the city slave. So, but this maps onto our ideas of the clever slave or the cunning slave versus the what is generally referred to as the running slave. So Grumio is the running slave, and Tranio is the clever slave of the two. And the play opens with a scene between the two of them, and we'll also kind of close with the two of them. So then what else did I want to talk here about? The young man of the play is Philolakes. You notice these are all Greek plays and are all set in Athens, which I think we can understand in two different contexts. One context is just the tradition itself. You're writing comedy, you're adapting Greek plays, so they're naturally going to be set in Athens. Makes sense from that respect. But the other dynamic here, and this is a thing that it plays both in tragedy and in comedy, and will continue to play in comedy, is for the Romans, like they want to have their comedies, right? But they can't happen in Rome, because in Rome a son would not disobey or try to deceive his father, because that's not what Romans do. It's absolute respect for the father. And so by kind of displacing this to Athens, it's like, oh, this is really funny. But no, it didn't happen here. It happened somewhere else. So we can laugh at it in a way that we would not be able to laugh at it if it was said at Rome, because that would imply that Romans don't have the, moral rectitude that Romans are supposed to have. You have another scene between two prostitutes, Philomathium and Scapha. One of them is young and beautiful, the other one is old and let me be kind, since I'm getting old too, wiser. There's a funny scene where they're talking to each other, where they're doing their makeup. And Philalaches, who's in love with Philomathium, is overhearing or eavesdropping on their conversation, and they say things, some of which please him, some of which offend him. The advice that Scapha, the older of the two prostitutes, gives Philomathium is that she should not limit herself to having only one lover. Because only one lover is, okay, so let me put this nicely. Don't put your eggs in one basket is the gist of her advice. There's a funny scene with Philalaches' friend, hell is his name? Kalodimates, who shows up with his girlfriend Delphium, but they're hammered and there's a whole drunk scene. But the principal problem within this play is that the dad's been away on business, right? So again, these sorts of like business, middle classy sorts of concerns. Dad's been away. But he returns unexpectedly. But Philalaches and Kalodimates have been partying the whole time, so Dad's gonna come back and find these things out and lay down the law. This is where the clever slave gets involved. Right, there's money owed that Philalaches borrowed to finance his good time having. So there's these like different balls in the air, but like I said, is I mean I'll say I said never fear, the clever slave is here. That's my phrase. What Tranio, the clever slave, says is that if you're skilled, if you have talent, it doesn't matter if you're master or slave. In other words, if you're smart, then whether you're the master or you're the slave, you can proposition your way out of any tricky situation. And of course, that's what ends up happening through Tranio's. So Theocrates shows up, and Tranio tells him, "Don't go near the house. The house is haunted. A long time ago, there somebody was murdered in here, and he's, buried under the house." And like if any of you, which I hope some of you have, it's an old movie by your standards, but the plot premise of the movie Poltergeist is that the movie is or that the house is built on an old Indian burial ground, right? So and therefore it becomes haunted, and yeah. Watch the movie if you haven't seen it. And again, I just want to point this out to you. I know I've said this a couple of times, and this is not the main point of this class, but if you like horror movies, remember, horror is an extension of comedy. It grows out of comedy. And we can talk about that at some point later in the future. The whole kind of like theme of architecture becomes a point in this play. It's throughout the whole play, really. I'm not going to go down the whole list here, but it's a thing, and it will remain a thing in comedy. So they go to look at the house next door, which Tranio claims that they've bought to move into, but the guy who owns the house next door, of course, is totally outside the loop on this particular scheme or scam, as the case may be, which leads to all kind of comic hilarity. I don't know what else to add to this. I mean, in the end, there's a marriage and or an engagement, and it ends like old comedy does. So I'm not going to take up too much time talking more about this. When we, in my opinion, when we deal with Roman old comedy or even Greek new, I'm sorry, I misspoke there. When we deal with Roman comedy, or when we deal with Greek new comedy, the comedy is in the plot of the play. It's in the circumstance. It's in the situation. It's not in the necessarily the immediate political moment, like it is when you read Aristophanes. So yeah, I mean, there's not. I don't really have much to add here. There's lots of, because I mean, so but there is one thing, like there's so Plautus is closer to Aristophanes in the sense that like his language is musical, and there's a lot of like coming on and off of stage, entrances and exits of various characters and in different scenes. So I mean, for me, like, and I know that not everybody would agree with this, but like, Aristophanes and Plautus kind of occupy similar, or I shouldn't say occupy. They manifest similar tendencies with respect to their approach to comedy, which is an emphasis on the inventiveness of language, the musicality of language, slapstick, and a kind of a, I suppose what I would sum up as a kind of a manicness on stage. Whereas with Menander, we haven't talked about Terence yet, so I'll leave. I would equate, not equate, I would compare Menander and Terence in their approaches to comedy, which I will do in the next lecture. And that's really all I have to say because well, I won't lay out my problems to you. Instead, I'm just going to play you a song for a little bit. Thank you. Not going to play the whole song because it's 15 minutes long. Of course, that's the great Herbie Hancock with Chameleon from the album Headhunters. That's what it is. I love you all. I miss you all. And I hope to see you all soon. Bye.